السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام الأتمان الأكملان على خير خلقه أجمعين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, all his companions, and all those who struggled and strove through the generations to bring the deen to us. We really ask Allah to bless them, and may we be from amongst the blessed as well. May we also study as much as possible, put into practice, convey the message in such a way that our offspring can also be part and parcel of the goodness. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I pray that you've had a good evening, mashallah, thinking about what we said yesterday, and at the same time pondering over ways of improvement. I spent part of the evening thinking of my own condition and how best we could actually improve. At the same time, on a daily basis, we face challenges. Every one of us faces challenges. These challenges are connected sometimes to our environment, sometimes to the people we interact with, sometimes to our own physical condition, mental state, psychological state, and so many other aspects. We mix sometimes with people whom, no matter what type of a promise we've made ourselves to be good people, you find that a person can irritate you sometimes, or they can really test you. And so when you just start thinking, I'm going to be a really exemplary human being, someone comes and messes it up or tries to mess it up, and sometimes without thinking we falter. And this is why, before you make an utterance, quickly think what you're doing and what you're saying, no matter what. Those who respond spontaneously usually can be controlled by people very easily. What this means is, if someone wants to make you angry and they know that they need you to become angry for them to overcome you, or for them to actually overpower you, in that case they can provoke you, and without thinking you can very, very quickly become angry and upset, and then they do what they have to, and then you are blamed. Take a look at sometimes the Muslims across the globe who react in such a typical way. Such a typical way. It's so easy for an enemy to just, you know, burn one Quran somewhere across the globe, and next thing you have 2 million Muslims who stand up and really engage in hooliganism, thinking that that's their duty towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Quran. Whereas they've never attempted to memorize it, they never bothered to look at it, they don't even know its meaning, they don't even put it into practice, so they've probably burnt it in a bigger way than the physical burning. We don't understand this, my brothers and sisters, and this is why it requires great intellect, insight, and it requires foresight as well, and it requires a lot of knowledge as to how to react. The reason I say this is, a lot of us set goals for ourselves. We do. We actually do. Those goals are sometimes not even connected to religion. They're connected sometimes to your workplace, your achievement in terms of certificates, and so on. And we make sure that we try our best to fulfill these goals. You know, by this year I should inshallah be married, maybe. By, you know, perhaps maybe 2 years time I'm due to graduate. I'd like to graduate with so much. And then I'd like to apply for a job at such a place and go to training at such a place. And by this time or by that time I'd like to achieve this type of a goal. And my salary should be sitting at X and Y and Z, and thereafter I'd like to have a home and so on. These are not bad. But did you balance it? Like we always say, we asked the question yesterday, we've got to keep on asking it, obviously, because we need to lead a balanced life. And a balanced life in Islam is a life that not only prepares for the next few years of itself in its nature of life, but of a different life altogether, which is the life after death as well. So you need to have prepared. And that, Allah says, all you need to do is lead your current life with rules and regulations
based on knowledge that you have learned in such a way that it will automatically result in the building of the hereafter for you. So always be focused on something grand rather than something that is very temporary in terms of long-term focus. Because the focus we have, we could divide it into two or three categories. We can say we have short-term focus, we have maybe medium-term focus, and then we have long-term focus. Short-term focus is perhaps that which you need to achieve within the next few years. Medium-term would be what you need to achieve within this life. And long-term, what you need to achieve for the life after death. If you think that long-term is connected to what you're going to achieve in 40 years' time, you know what? You may not live to see those 40 years, number one. Number two is, in 40 years, you will probably be somewhere where you did not even plan to be at that particular time, which means in your grave. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us conscious of the stark reality. It glares us in our faces. We see our friends going. We see young people die of various causes. But we sometimes have forgotten that the goals we have set for ourselves do not accommodate the possibility and probability of this happening to us as well. This is why we need to spend a few moments focusing. Focusing on the fact that the lens we are looking through at this particular moment should take us beyond mere life. Allahu Akbar. The lens that we are focusing through should take us beyond mere life. And this is when you would have to go through the lives of those who have succeeded both in this world and the next. Take a look at Abdurrahman ibn Auf radiyallahu anhu, one of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. At the time of the hijrah, he owned almost nil. First day, he tells his brother meaning the one whom he was fostered with in terms of ukhuwa or brotherhood. As you know, when the muhajirin got to Medina Munawwara and met with the Ansar, and I'm sure you would know this in the history of Islam, there was something known as Al-Mu'akha that took place between the two. It was a solution which prevented what we would term as refugees. So a whole town came into another town and they mixed with them in a way that nobody was homeless. And nobody really felt the burden of anyone having come to them. So if we are seated here today, perhaps 600 to 700 people, we would be able to solve the problems of 600 to 700 people. If each one of us took home one, subhanallah, neither would it pinch our pockets, nor would it become a major issue for us. But at the same time, it would resolve the crisis for so many people in such a short time. May Allah protect us. The problem with us, we're too closed to even allow that. And we wouldn't really blame one who doesn't really want that at this moment, because one would not be able to guarantee the genuineness of those who are entering their homes. Because our hearts are not like the hearts of the first generation. Our hearts have changed a lot. Where some people would pretend to be refugees only to live a happy life, to leech onto a system that perhaps might be offering them something slightly better than what they are living in, maybe, yet they don't really have a crisis that would deserve asylum. May Allah protect us. Wow, these words sound very, very political. Allahu Akbar. Beautiful. MashaAllah, we learn this in Islam. And if you look at this man, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, radiallahu anhu, he tells his brother, he says, show me to the market. So he was shown to the market. He came back that evening with a handsome profit. Yet he started off with naught, zero. No interest loans, no payments to be made. The man not only had a goal that he set for himself for the day, but he had a vision of how to operate in a way that he will achieve it by the help of Allah, without leeching here or there. So he started his day, mashallah, and he went further, and he came back with a profit. Later on, he became very soon one of the top rich members of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Do you know that? He was one of the wealthy of the lot. One of the more wealthy of the lot. The clothing he wore was so expensive at a certain stage that automatically people would be able to know this man is loaded, so to speak, in our terms. And yet, he was a man who did not miss his salah. He was a man who was humbled. He surrendered to every murmur of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know what that means? He gave his focus on the life after death primary strength. And that was his primary aim, the main thing. All that he achieved in this world was all by the way. It came because he was an honest, upright businessman who struck proper deals, and he was loved by the people he dealt with. He always gave people, you know, the benefit of the deal, and he always tried to be conscious of the person whom he was buying from, as well as conscious of the person whom he was selling to, and so on. And we need to go into this history, because in the next few minutes, we are not going to be able to go deep into their lives. But please, my brothers and sisters, it's not so difficult to find out about the lives of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know they are called Sahaba radiallahu anhum. It's not so difficult. So many books, so many websites have been dedicated to study the lives of the stars of Islam. It's up to us to make an effort to see how they were from amongst the top mathematicians, but they were powerful Muslims. If you looked at them, they looked like saints of Islam today, perhaps. Subhanallah. Yet, they were actually academics who studied and who achieved not only for the Muslim Ummah, but contributed to mathematics today. Allahu Akbar. Today, you look at the history of medicine, for example. If they were to remove the Muslim names from there, we would have nothing remaining of medicine, of the initial medicine. What happened to us? Where did we go? Perhaps our focus has drifted because it is not holistic. Those people achieved because their focus was upon the Akhirah. That was the long-term focus. The short-term focus was upon what is it that I can achieve, not only for myself, but for the Ummah, humanity at large, those to come up to the end of time. They were focused on that as short-term, medium-term focus. So the combination of all these three elements of focus made them people who really achieved a lot. Take a look at Khawarizmi, take a look at the others. It's up to us to go and study who they were, what they achieved. Ibn Sina, for example. These names I'm sure we would know. The problem is we've never ever, or a lot of us have not, made the effort to find out exactly what they've achieved. And sometimes, and I have seen on the net, rough images of who they were. Not to say we promote that. Obviously in Islam it's prohibited to draw some portraits and so on. But we would know that whoever did it is coming up with roughly what they looked like based on the descriptions. Because the non-Muslims have taken to the Muslims as their role models in terms of medicine, in terms of mathematics, in terms of geography, and so many other fields. Even the scientists, you know, astronomy and so on, you find the Muslim names deep, deep within these fields. And sometimes they give them an accent so that they don't sound Muslim anymore. They give them an accent. And it happens to us up to today, you know, you have a beautiful Muslim name, and because you don't want anyone to know it, because you're so ashamed, rather than being like those people who were of lofty aspirations and those people who had great goals, you know what they did? They made sure that people knew that they were Muslimin. That's what they did. So that the whole world knew that the contribution to medicine came from the Muslims. In fact, do you know that cleanliness and how to keep ourselves clean was actually taught by Islam and given as a gift to the globe, including to Europe? Do you know that? Go and find out. So how to bathe and bath? If you look at some of the medieval kings or some of the leaders in ancient Europe, you would find they hardly bathed. They made a huge issue of their bathing, which happened once a year. I'm not joking. And today, subhanAllah, we use fresh water. We have a system of bathing, a system of cleansing. And we still teach all those who do not know the Islamic teachings how exactly to wash up after you've used the bathroom. Subhanallah. Amazing. Never be shy of these teachings. More and more bathrooms are finding water within in order to cleanse thoroughly and properly, to avoid disease and sickness. But we don't even look at that sometimes as some achievement. We don't even look at it as something to be proud of. Yet one day, being seated with a non-Muslim, one of my close colleagues says that he was asked about one teaching. He says, tell me one teaching in Islam that makes it unique. And this man is a very knowledgeable person who was asked. And I was so surprised to learn that he said, something unique about Islam is it teaches you how to wash thoroughly after using the bathroom. This man who was a religious leader of the Christians, meaning the man who was listening to this statement, he was stumped. Basically, he didn't know what to say. Really, today would you tell that to anyone? Someone were to ask you, tell me something amazing about your religion. Would you ever have thought about it? Well, that's from a hadith. That's from the sayings of the companions. مَا تَرَكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ خَيْرًا إِلَّا وَدَلَّنَا عَلَيْهِ وَلَا شَرًّا إِلَّا حَذَّرَنَا مِنْهِ. And in one narration, he says, حَتَّى الْخِرَاءَ أَوِ الْخُرَاءَ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has not left any goodness except that he taught us about it. And he has not left any evil except that he has warned us about it. Anything bad, he's warned us about it. And the narration says, including how to wash up after using the bathroom. That's the narration. That means it's something important, it's something unique. So the point I'm making, going back to these people who achieved so much, they were Muslim. They did not miss their prayers at all, but they achieved so much. They were the top doctors of the globe. Today, I'm sure we have some top doctors on the globe who are actually Muslim. And I'd like to hope and pray that they don't miss their salah and that they make their Islamic identity well known so that the globe knows that Islam has contributed to us and to our goodness. But today the globe only knows Islam as being a religion that has people who do not tolerate others. Yet they are in such a minority that we would eclipse those handful who actually have this type of attitude completely. The problem with us, we don't like to make our Islamic identity loud and clear when we do good things. Or if we do, it's something very small and minor. Why don't we come up clear with it? You know, at your workplace you've achieved. You notice what the Christians do and the others. When they do a good deed, they are very intelligent. They would say, well, you know what? First and foremost, I'm a Christian. That's why I've brought back this thing that you had lost to you. I'm a Christian. They'll help you somewhere and then they'll say, no hassle, no problem, I'm a Christian, you know. Why add the flavor? It's important to add it because people need to know. Your name should be synonymous with something good. The Muslims are lacking in that, really. It's so difficult for us to say, mashallah, you know what inspired me to be the top in my company? I'm a Muslim. How many of us would actually say that? I don't want to answer the question, but I want to ask it for us to continue answering it the day we achieve something. The day we achieve a goal we'd like to. I was top in my class. For example, someone would say, because I'm a Muslim and Islam has taught me dedication. I got up early every day and I still get up at the same time. And I make sure that after that I have this system in place because Islam has trained me to achieve that. Amazing. What happens with us? We sometimes lose that focus. So your goal is there. When you achieve it, you do not relate it to your maker. But whilst you were achieving it, let's be honest, we all sit up and make lots of dua to the same maker. When we want to pass an examination tomorrow, or when we have an interview tomorrow, or later on today something is about to happen, we sit, we read our salah, we become saints, we become top Muslims, and we start saying, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, oh my maker, I have an examination tomorrow, grant me success. We will tweet the whole globe to make dua for us because we have an examination tomorrow. And everyone says, Ameen, Ameen, and we're so excited and we look at it, wow, 500 people said Ameen for my examination. When we pass it, we never ever relate it to the fact that we are Muslimin and the dua was made, or we worked dedicatedly calling out to Allah and asking Him to help us to be able to contribute towards society and so on. We forget about that. What made us forget? I'd like to think our weakness or the distraction that the devil causes in our lives. We forget. And I'm honest with you. I have asked, and I always like to ask, because we need to know the level of the people. Ask some people about how they were, how many examinations they've had in their lives where they really called out to Allah, and they will tell you every time we have an exam, we become saints. Such that we promise Allah, those sins we committed, never again. Not ever. No ways. It's over. Ya Allah, I just need to pass. And as soon as we pass, we're back there. So this is why Allah describes this type of attitude in the Quran, giving a different example.
فَإِذَا رَكِبُوا فِي الْفُلْكِ دَعَوُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ فَلَمَّا نَجَّاهُمْ إِلَى الْبَرِّ إِذَا هُمْ يُشْرِكُونَ.
Allah says, do you know the polytheists? They do the same thing. Why? When they are on the boat at sea and the boat is rocking, subhanallah, the boat is rocking. I'll tell you a story about a boat rocking in a few minutes. When they are at sea and the boat is rocking, you find them calling out to their maker alone, realizing the only one who can help us out of this mess is the maker. And as soon as they arrive on the coast, they return back to their polytheism, forgetting that maker that they were calling out to. Is this our attitude? We suffer a loss and we become saints. We gain a profit and suddenly we are the first at the casino. We are the ones who waste our money, gambling, drugging, clubbing, whatever else it is. May Allah protect us. May He make us from those really whose goals can save them from engaging in bad. Because my goal and yours ultimately is what? What is my ultimate goal? One word. Paradise. That is my ultimate goal. People say, but... And I've had speeches with a few people who are atheistic, you know, don't believe in anything. And I tell them, wallahi, you don't lose anything by being good. You actually lead a pure life. And they tell you, you know what? You're going to miss out. You live once. Enjoy it and enjoy it thoroughly. Do whatever comes to your mind because you live once. And you tell them, and wallahi, this is a fact. And I've repeated this so many times. You can actually tell them, look my brother, if what you say is correct, I have lost nothing. But if what I say is correct, you've lost everything. So the possibilities here and the probabilities from a totally, you know, intellectual point of view, secular point of view, would be that you follow what I say because you would not lose a thing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding, really. My brothers and sisters, it's about time. We took a look into the lives of the successful. And we took a look at the names of those who achieved, starting from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. You know, the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the messengers. Those are known to us. Aspects of them are mentioned in the Quran. They were of a level very high. Yet we are taught to emulate. We are taught to copy what they did, in the sense that look at their lives and how they led them and lead a life similarly. So we hear the Quran saying,
لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ.
Indeed, for you in the Messenger, peace be upon him, is a great example to emulate and to follow. And on top of that, Allah tells the Messenger himself,
أولئك الذين هدى الله فبهداهم اقتده.
Allah makes mention to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the stories of the messengers before him. And Allah says, those are the ones whom Allah had guided rightly. So follow their footsteps and their guidance. Allahu Akbar. This message is for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which would mean we also need to look into the lives of the previous messengers and learn lessons to be able to apply in our lives. From there, we would go to the companions. Like I say, they are human beings. They were not prophets. So perhaps closer for us to understand the example of. They were the wealthy from amongst them. They were the highly educated from amongst them. How did they operate? How many people did they assist in their lives? How much did they contribute to humanity? Subhanallah. Take a look at the life of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. I always say, he ruled so many countries of today's countries that if you were to put a pencil mark around the area that he governed, you would count 35 countries of today. Do you know that? Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu. Amazing. What a man. And he used to walk on the streets. He used to go out at night on his own to find out what was going on. People in other cities were worried about their news getting to him if they did anything bad. Yet, no Twitter, no Facebook, no internet. You know that? No Google. No Skype. No Tango. What else? Allahu Akbar. We know so many names of so many applications, and yet we don't fear anything. Subhanallah. At that time, Umar ibn al-Khattab ruled with so much justice. And we need to learn from this example. How was he with the people? When the Romans sent their messengers, they arrived at the seat of Islam at the time, and they began to ask, who is the Amir? We want to see. In fact, they arrived at one of the poshest homes they found, thinking that this must be the Amir, only to be told, no ways, his house is the other one there. The little house that you see in the corner, that's it. What? His house is one of the smallest houses around? Well, he was on a mission. He had to rule with justice. Everything was transparent. Today's leaders can take a lesson from his life. It's a fact. Complete and total transparency. Everyone knew what was going on. He was such a man that he did not take one date out of turn. Not one date out of turn. And so, when they arrived at the home, they were told, he is not here. When they began to ask, it was afternoon, time of the afternoon. They began to ask, where is this man? And someone told them, you see that tree down there? There is someone resting under the tree. That is our Amir. A man ruling 35 countries, resting in the afternoon under a tree, well fast asleep. Allahu Akbar. They went there, they were shocked. As he got up, they looked at him. The famous utterances, O Umar. You have been given the opportunity to rule, hakamta. You have ruled, meaning you are ruling over your people. And because you have been just, which means you deal with justice, complete justice, transparency and so on. Therefore, you are so secure, which means you are feeling so safe, and therefore you have slept under a tree. Look, they understood. How can a leader sleep under a tree? He needs to feel very safe. How does he feel very safe? Because he is just. He is a proper person who really is not worried about who you are and what you are. What's right is right and what's wrong is wrong. And he knows he has a system that works. And this is what they understood, that if he is secure, that's the only time he could sleep under a tree. And to achieve that type of security, you need to be really just, serving your people dedicatedly. And then they told him, that's why you are ruling here. You are feeling so safe and secure. We have a lot to look at and to learn from that. What was the goal of Umar ibn al-Khattab in all that? His goal was not to fill his pockets, nor was his goal to seize the opportunity of his post in order to achieve anything clandestine. But rather, his worry and concern day and night was, will I achieve paradise or not? So much so that he went to Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, who was a friend of his and a companion, compatriot and colleague. And he says, oh Hudhayfa, I know that you've been given the names of the hypocrites. I know that you've been given the names of the hypocrites from amongst us. And I know that it is a confidential matter. And the messenger has told you not to release those names. But all I need to ask you, and he says this with tears in his eyes, is Umar's name in that list? That is hair raising. A man who was told you are from amongst those who will enter paradise is still worried that that might be snatched away from him. And he is asking, is my name from amongst the hypocrites? And we sit here engaging in hypocrisy and we're not worried of anything. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. You think you've achieved? He ruled 35 countries, more than anyone today. Take a look at the blocks that they've created. Whether it is a block of the Asian countries or a block of the European countries or any. Do you see any block that is operational thoroughly, properly, which has one leadership that has 35 countries in it? The answer is no, it does not exist. And yet that man, he ruled it by the way. That was not his main aim in life. His main aim was to achieve paradise. It was the life after death. How many of us would even dream to rule our own home. Our children don't listen to us. We are insecure in our own house. Our children make dua, oh Allah, take my mother away urgently because she's a pain in the really wrong place. Our children say, oh Allah, take my father away. I've seen him doing so much bad evil. Oh Allah, he's such a bad person. Take him away. Is that the type of life we're leading? And yet we claim to be Muslimin. Look, those who achieved what we would term today secularly, it was nothing of that nature a long time ago. It was all considered something spiritual. Your duty to Allah is to really contribute as much as you can to humanity, my brothers and sisters, but not forgetting that your main aim is actually the pleasure of your maker. That is it. You can be, like I always say, the CEO of any company, the president of any nation. You serve, inshallah, thoroughly and properly, not forgetting that all that service will have been a waste of your time if you do not prepare or did not prepare for the day you were to meet your maker. So today we are motivating one and all to go back into the lives of those who have achieved, because sometimes we forget what we've achieved, and sometimes we look at ourselves as Muslim and we don't even realize that we owned the seat of the globe for more than 600 years. And how was that achieved? It was achieved through being focused upon the loftiest of goals you could ever have had. The minute the focus was changed, we lost everything. We lost it all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Like I say, they have achieved. Today people think if you want to achieve in the secular world, you must really not be a good Muslim, or you must hide your Islamic identity. That is why people think so low of Islam, because they don't know that the big achievers even today are people with Muslim names. Those who've contributed to society, those who are business people, who are honest, working hard, have employed so many people, for example, contributing to the economies of so many countries, they are Muslimin. The wealthiest on the globe, sometimes you find names of Muslims near the top of the list. Where is the benevolence? Where is the mercy towards mankind? Where is the assistance? Because Muslims are also suffering the most on the globe at this moment. If we were to pay our zakat correctly, the dues, the charities correctly, in a way that was coordinated, well-mannered, we would not have a single poor Muslim on the globe. Not only that, we would be reaching out to entire humanity. Believe me, subhanallah. If the charities of the wealthy, a small percentage of their wealth was directed correctly and used properly for the poor of the globe, today we would eradicate poverty even amongst the non-Muslims. But our own brothers and sisters wait for handouts from people who are not affiliated to our deen in any way, who volunteer to go across the globe, far and wide, in order to help those who are homeless, suffering, those who are caught up in the crossfire, innocent people who are homeless, women and children and so on, who have no clothing, no food. And yet the Muslims are sitting fat, sitting wealthy, sitting okay, each one of them dedicated towards achieving a few more thousand, a few more million, a few more in terms of wealth, in terms of material wealth. Yet we have not yet reached out to those closest to us. One might ask, one might say, how do we reach out? There are so many ways. Start off by reaching out to your own family. There is a disaster in a lot of Muslim homes today because we've lost focus. Our goals are no more there. Our goal becomes material, and materialism includes, really, materialism includes, and this is very sad to say, I don't even feel like saying what I'm about to say, but I will say it. May Allah protect us. Loss of focus, materialism, includes where people's goal is to commit adultery with someone, and that's their aim. They give themselves 2 months, 2 months time, I must be in bed with X, Y, or Z. It is happening, my brothers and sisters. And these are some of the goals that are so low that have resulted in us breaking our homes. Our own spouses who've dedicated their lives to us are not even considered as worthwhile to be looked at, because our goals are heading in the direction sometimes of Satan. although what I've just said might be a very small number of people, believe me, dirt is growing rather than purity. But it is reminders of this nature which are quite serious that would make us think, my brother, my sister, through sin you will achieve absolutely nothing. If you have bedded, if you know what I mean, if you have bedded the most handsome or the most pretty of the lot of the globe, what did you achieve? A day will come when you are on your deathbed too, and death will begin to bed you. Yes. Then what are you going to say on that day? So sin will get you nowhere. It is a temporary pleasure. Have you ever thought of it? So temporary that even those who gamble, you know, they might achieve millions and billions once. The rest of the time you lose. You lose more than you gain. It is very temporary. And for this reason, besides one or two, nearly all of those who've won major massive lotteries have lost their families in the process and become suicidal in no time. And Google will tell you that. You just need to search like what I did. Believe me. You know, I was so interested. I saw 2 days ago that someone, an elderly person, perhaps in their 80s, a granny, won one of the biggest lotteries ever in US history and so on. I see people nodding their heads. You might have seen the same thing. And I told myself, if she is perhaps a person who might be slightly straight, she might die a happy woman, maybe, perhaps, in her own way of happiness. But I wonder what will happen to all that as soon as she goes. People are eyeing it out. One wonders, I hope and I pray that she is not knocked off as a result. Because if she dies tomorrow, there will be a huge investigation into her heirs to see who might have done what. Do you know that? May Allah bless us all. The best of wealth is that which you've earned with your own sweat. It comes with barakah. It comes with blessings, even if it is just a mere few dollars. So the sin that we engage in, what it does, it blocks us from our main goal and aim. And we become short-term and in the wrong way. So Allah says, you can regain focus, my beloved worshippers. All you need to do is engage in tawbah. Put on the new spectacles, look with a different lens, see clearly, and walk forth, and you will find great success. You see that? Take off those lenses that were of a different color, perhaps yellow, that made you see everything yellow, and put on those which are clear, where you can see crystal clear. Your goal is in front of you at all times. That is your aspiration. And whenever you falter here and there, because we are human beings, devil comes to us, shaitan comes to us regularly. Wherever we falter here and there, remember, the Almighty has always given us the space to come back to the path. You just need to turn to Allah, admit that you were wrong, ask Him for forgiveness, promise you won't do it again, regret about it, and that's it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us regret over our sins. And may He give us the opportunity really to get closer to Him as the days pass and not move further away as the days pass. Every one of us is struggling in our own way in life. And I've repeated this so many times because it's a fact. So what do you do? Try your best. T-R-Y. That trial will get you to paradise. Do you know that? But if you think I'm a write-off, write-off as in W-R-I-T-E, I'm written off, that's it. No hope for me. Such people are caught by the clutch of the devil. They have no long-term goal of paradise because they feel, you know what? I'm already going to hell. So now, what's the point of not enjoying whatever my brain and mind wants me to in this particular world? And this is why, if you take a look at those who don't follow any rules and regulations in this world and they do as their whims and fancies tell them, they lead a very, very narrow life in terms of contentment. They are never happy, no matter what they have. Take a look at those who have no sexual morals. They have no morality in terms of their sexual behavior. Take a look at them. What do they achieve? They might be able to tell you, you know what, I've slept with 1,000 people. They are either suffering disease, they have a mental problem, they either have a broken home, they perhaps might be thinking of so many weird things, they are still not happy and their figure still wants to go higher. And at the end of the day, when they die, one wonders on the deathbed, and this we still need to see, may Allah protect us. On the deathbed, one wonders what thoughts will go through their mind, because they really don't know where they are going. They really do not know where they are going. They've never thought about it besides towards the end. And this is why we say they've achieved nothing. Those who've stolen the wealth of others, how much have they stolen? Say they've stolen $1 million. That million they used from amongst it, perhaps 200,000. They bought a house and so on. That house, what happened to it? Only Allah knows. And the remainder, they never ever used it. So why did they steal it? Allahu Akbar. Why did they steal it? Why pinch? When you steal, you lead a life full of worry that you're going to get caught tomorrow. When you've been immoral as a married person, you are worried that your picture might come out in the paper tomorrow. Yes. You're worried that you might be exposed to the human beings. What about Allah, who has already seen you? Today we are worried about CCTV. Allahu Akbar. Yet the Almighty has something much more sophisticated than that. And He says, you want to delete? You want to format? All you need to do is engage in tawbah. Just say, oh Allah, format it for me and I will do it. Allahu Akbar. Look at the mercy of Allah. Refocus. Regain that focus. So inshallah we will go back and we will look at the lives of the companions and we will look at those who have achieved. It's not difficult. I've seen so many clips on YouTube, so many articles on the net which are actually brilliantly worded and well put regarding the achievements of the Muslims over history and time. And you start thinking, why doesn't the world of today know this? Well, if you do something about it, the world will definitely know, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept the achievements of those of the past always as a means of encouragement for all those who will follow, in such a way that today if we achieve something great by the will of Allah, we will leave a legacy for those who are to come. And we will really not only be of benefit to our own offspring and those of our own faith, but to humanity at large. Amazing. They will look at us and say, these people have achieved. These people are the ones whom we should be following. But until we have not regained that focus and we have not looked into their lives and we have not perhaps understood the plan of the Almighty, we may not get there in a rush. So let us learn to turn, and let us learn to help one another to turn, and let us understand that this life is extremely temporary. Whatever you've achieved, inshallah, will come to your benefit. My 45 minutes are up. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us all. Until we meet again later on, we say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.